Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Continental Reckoning, The American West and the Age of Expansion, by Elliott West, narrated by Christopher Grove. Richard Edelain, Series Editor's Introduction. Historical writing about the American West has undergone dramatic changes in the past half century and more. Specifically, historians have moved away from the frontier thesis of Frederick Jackson Turner and turned in new directions. Earlier authors such as Henry Nash Smith and Earl Pomeroy helped us understand how the mythic West and Western imitations of European and Eastern American traditions shaped the history of the region. Other recent Western histories highlight the roles of racial and ethnic groups, women and families, and urbanization in the development of the West. And widely recognized from the late 1980s onward is a new Western history that has brought forth a darker, more complex side of the region's past. These historiographical shifts compel us to ask new questions about the history of the American West and to re-examine the past in light of our experiences in the late 20th and early 21st centuries. Fresh sociological, demographic, and environmental topics are being addressed. For many specialists in the field, the regional West has supplanted the frontier West, with place being emphasized more than process. It's time for a new comprehensive history of the American West, one that reflects new scholarship without overlooking past perspectives. Volumes in the History of the West series do just that. A History of the Region in 6 volumes, the series builds on these recent historiographical treatments of gender, ethnicity, and the environment. The volumes reflect current thoughts about the West as a region, provide a judicious blend of old and new subject matter, and offer narratives that appeal to specialists and general listeners. In this book, Elliott West meets and exceeds the large goals of these series volumes. His wide-reaching overview of the American West from the 1840s to the 1880s overflows with storytelling achievements, superb research, and a new framework for viewing this near half-century. This volume illustrates why Elliott West ranks at the top of historians writing about the American West. West knows how to tell interest-whetting stories. He employs numerous biographical vignettes and illuminative moments to give exceptional narrative power to his story. Pen portraits of individuals and notable events also enlarge the draw of his account. In addition, West also displays his thorough, diligent research. He moves beyond the usual stories and adds new information. For example, about the California Gold Rush, the building of the transcontinental railroads, and frontier mining and agricultural endeavors. He shows, too, the ongoing shaping influences of the East on the West. These cross-continental connections are invaluable for understanding this period of Western history. Listeners will be drawn to West's superb use of statistics. West utilizes census and other statistical sources to substantiate and enlarge his overarching interpretations of the West, and often gives these interpretations with inviting bits of humor. This skillful use of numbers allows West to lard his history with dozens of valuable comparisons. West also delivers a broad-based story. He displays manifold interests in topics such as race and ethnicity, gender, and the environment. Moving beyond earlier historians linked to the frontier interpretations of Frederick Jackson Turner, West delivers a narrative similar to that of the new Western historians, but surpasses them in his balance and storytelling power. The most important contribution of West's extensive and invaluable study is its illustration of his greater reconstruction thesis, the most notable historiographical idea advanced about the American West in the 21st century. West's greater reconstruction thesis urges historians to build a two-pronged story of this era of Western history by bringing together simultaneous emphases on the coming of, the duration of, and the after effects of the Civil War, alongside the major happenings of the westward movement stretching from the 1840s to the 1880s. Seen and considered together, these two major plot strains are at the center of West's greater Reconstruction idea and of this book. Altogether, then, this is an extraordinary Western history, full of provocative insights, fresh information, and storytelling power. It will capture listeners and win major prizes. Prelude. 773,510,680 acres. Between February 19, 1846, and July 4, 1848, the United States acquired more than 1.2 million square miles of land. It was far and away the greatest expansion in the nation's history, more than half again what had been added in the Louisiana Purchase more than four decades earlier. Should the nation add that much today, expanding not to the west but to the south, our borders would embrace all of Mexico, Guatemala, Honduras, Nicaragua, Belize, El Salvador, Costa Rica, Panama, and more than half of Colombia. If you prefer to think more globally, imagine that during the 28 months and 15 days after you hear this sentence, the United States will add to itself land just short of that in modern India. The consequences over the next three or so decades were considerable. My goal has been to explore them in a couple of ways. I have tried to tell the birth of the West as a region, to see it take form as a political entity, as an arrangement of power, as part of a global community, and as imagined space. And I have tried to situate its birth in the broader narrative of American history. For the first goal, the problem was not finding things to write about, but choosing among them and fitting them into something approaching a sensible whole. All history is about movement and change, but the pace and scope here was of a rare order. Events come quickly, stumbling over each other, crackling with energy, shifting and interlacing. A collective bewilderment. Trying to write their history can feel like being told to imitate a mockingbird or to cook authentic chili. Many episodes are well cited in popular memory. Wagon trains rolling westward, horseback herdsmen, Indian wars, gold and silver strikes, homesteading mothers, Hispanic farmers with their acequias. I have tried to honor that popular interest while seeing those events freshly in light of new research, of wider perspectives, and of common sense. I have tried also to introduce much that has an equal claim to consequence, and yet is too rarely seen in the traditional script. Revolutionizing technologies, scientists reshaping basic human understandings, environmental upheavals and human atrocities, global bonds of commerce and capital. As the second goal, I have tried to suggest how these events and developments should encourage us to look anew at, to literally revise, what is by scholarly acclamation one of the most pivotal periods of American history. During the middle of the 19th century, the trajectory of the United States shifted fundamentally onto a course that would carry it into what we would come to recognize as modern America. Among the changes were the steep acceleration of the nation's economic power and the rearrangement of that power, an increasing mastery of new technologies, the reordering of the nation's racial relations and its redefinition of citizenship, its growing engagement in global revolutions of knowledge, a profound transformation in its non-human environments, the expanding role of the federal government in its public life, and a wider, invigorated engagement with a larger world, one embracing both of the oceans that now formed its border. To explain this new trajectory, historians usually have focused on the Civil War and the events that touched most immediately on its causes and consequences. We would do well, however, to avoid what Joel Silby, more than 50 years ago, called the Civil War synthesis, which begins with the fact of the war, then views events around it only in relation to that fact. In particular, we should broaden our view in both space and time. We should pull back spatially to a perspective from coast to coast that allows a far more prominent role for the emergence of the West and the changes it brought. That, in turn, requires us to pull back temporally, to view the shift in trajectory as beginning in the mid-1840s and coming into sharpening focus at the traditional end of the Civil War era, around 1880. The Civil War and the birth of the West, that is, should be given something like equal billing in this crucial transition in national life. Each event has its own story and deserves its own narrative, but each was often in conversation with the other, and when each is properly considered in its broadest context, neither can be understood without the other. Elsewhere, I have suggested that the resulting picture is of a greater reconstruction, one that included not only rejoining the Southeast and Northeast after 1865, but also the remaking of the nation at large during the 30-plus years after expansion to the Pacific. The story is of events, East and West, that together preserved the Republic while expanding it, reaffirming it, and binding its parts into a new America that was continental in scope and recast in its composition and purposes. The Birth of the West also offers a collective testimony, compelling, inspirational, horrifying, funny, bizarre, of what it was like to live through one of the more telling chapters of our common past. Such testimony should be considered part of an American literature, oral in this case, that deserves a place in a broader view of the contours of our past. When I could, I have tried to let the speakers have their say. The hope is to give at least parts of the story a somebodiness, to provide the big picture with voices. If the argument is that expansion between 1845 and 1848 began a fundamental restructuring of the nation, its prelude should start briefly with that expansion and the forces behind it. It came in three interrelated episodes. The first was the annexation of Texas. In 1836, it had won its independence from Mexico, though Mexico continued formally to consider it a state in rebellion. Although opinion in Texas strongly favored joining the United States, a growing sentiment in the Northeast against expansion of African-American slavery scuttled the possibility. For 10 years, Texas would remain its own nation. By then, factions in the Democratic Party strongly favored inviting the Lone Star Republic. And when the favorite for the 1844 nomination, Martin Van Buren of New York, opposed it, the party turned instead to James Knox Polk of Tennessee, who campaigned for annexing both Texas and the Oregon country of the Pacific Northwest, territory strongly desired by voters in the anti-Texas Northeast. Polk's strategy, that is, was to offset opposition to some expansion, not by hedging his support for it, but by promising to expand still more. When he narrowly defeated the Whig stalwart Henry Clay of Kentucky, his victory was widely assumed to be popular approval of a vigorous and general expansion. The current president, John Tyler, an expansionist who had been read out of the Whig Party for his views, meanwhile had negotiated a treaty of annexation, but the Senate rejected it after the new Secretary of State, John Calhoun, publicly linked it to the preservation of black slavery. Tyler, arguing that in the election voters had made their wishes clear, called for inviting the Republic through a constitutionally dubious joint congressional resolution that needed only simple majorities in both houses. That passed by a whisker. On the eve of his departure, Tyler extended the offer to Texas, which approved annexation in a summer convention and by popular vote in the fall. Polk signed legislation admitting Texas 2 days before the end of 1845, and on February 19, 1846, Texas formally relinquished its sovereignty to the United States. The first gulp of new land was done. The second was entwined with it. Polk had courted Northeastern support by calling for acquiring the Oregon Country, territory from the northern boundary of present California to the 54th parallel 40 minutes, today's southern boundary of Alaska. East to west, it went from the Continental Divide to the Pacific Ocean. Spain and Russia had abandoned claims to the area, and the United States and England had agreed to allow each other's citizens to work and settle there, and to forswear any military presence. The only land truly disputed was south of the 49th parallel, our current boundary with Canada, and enclosed within the long curve of the Columbia River. England's Hudson's Bay had profited hugely from this beaver-rich country, and fur trade hopefuls in the United States looked on it covetously. Meanwhile, Methodist and Presbyterian missionaries were boosting the country below the Columbia as an agrarian wonderland, and by 1844, hopeful farm families were settling the fertile Willamette River Valley. It was to such interests that Polk appealed in 1844, and once in office he secretly proposed a division of the Oregon country along the 49th parallel. Through a slightly comic series of miscommunications, England seemed to refuse. Polk's response was to break negotiations, demand everything up to Russian America, and ask Congress to serve notice of ending joint occupation. The implication was that he was ready to fight. The English government, in fact, had been amenable to Polk's initial offer, the Hudson's Bay Company having moved its main post to the southern tip of Vancouver Island. A new government under Prime Minister Robert Peel and his Secretary for Foreign Affairs, Lord Aberdeen, proposed dividing along the line long considered the 49th parallel, but bending around Vancouver Island to keep it in English hands. Polk accepted. For all the bluster, the confrontation was, writes historian Frederick Merck, one of a kernel of reality and an enormous husk, with both sides agreeing to what was likely the outcome from the start. The signing of the Oregon Treaty on June 15, 1846, gave the United States the present states of Washington, Oregon, Idaho, and a bit of Montana. The second gulp was accomplished. The third, both bloodier and more complicated, brought the acquisition of California and the Southwest. Polk was committed to Texas's claim, based on virtually nothing, that its western boundary extended to the Rio Grande in its entirety, which would include Santa Fe, the mercantile and political center, increasingly bound by trade to the Missouri Valley. Like the three presidents before him, he had further ambitions beyond Texas. California's Central Valley had a ripening reputation of an agrarian paradise, and had already drawn small but growing numbers of farmers. There were, besides, California's ports, above all the Bay at San Francisco, increasingly regarded as one of the world's finest, and which was nicely situated as a base for trade of whatever sort around the Pacific. This left Polk playing a double and contradictory diplomatic game. He would press Mexico to recognize Texas annexation, to accept, that is, what Mexico considered an invasion, while also trying to persuade it to sell California and the Southwest in pursuit of his own political goals. It did not go well. In December of 1845, he sent John Slidell of Louisiana to offer up to $25 million to settle disputes and acquire New Mexico and California. But Polk sent Slidell as minister plenipotentiary, which in diplomatic language meant that meeting with him would imply that relations were reestablished, which in turn would imply that Mexico had accepted of the loss of Texas. A rebuffed Slidell wrote home that a war would probably be the best mode of getting what was desired. General Zachary Taylor and 4,000 troops were already on the Nueces River, the actual extent of the Texans' occupation, and Polk now sent them down to the Rio Grande, clearly looking for confrontation. None came. Polk was about to ask for a declaration of war based on Mexico's delinquency in paying a $2 million debt, when word arrived that Mexican Cavalry Command had engaged American dragoons north of the Rio Grande and killed 11. Polk hastily rewrote his address to charge that Mexico had invaded the nation and that American blood had been shed upon the American soil. With some Whig opposition, Congress assented. Many in Washington predicted a short and successful war. They were disappointed. Mexico put up far greater resistance than expected, and once its defeat was obvious, it was reluctant to concede. Taylor took Matamoros and Monterey, and in February 1847, his outnumbered men defeated an untrained and exhausted command under Mexican President Antonio López de Santa Anna at the village of Buena Vista near Saltillo. Texas was secure. New Mexico had been taken 6 months earlier. As Brigadier General Stephen Watts Kearny led the newly created Army of the West from Fort Leavenworth toward Santa Fe, a group of influential Anglos argued persuasively to Governor Manuel Armijo that his position was untenable. Armijo negotiated a bloodless surrender and took up for Chihuahua. Local resentment, in particular among the clergy and Pueblo Indians, erupted in a rebellion in Taos, north of Santa Fe, that killed the new governor, Charles Bent, and a few other officials. But troops from Santa Fe commanded by Colonel Sterling Price suppressed the revolt after a bit more than 2 weeks. 6 days before the rebellion, a treaty had secured California, at least on paper. In the summer of 1845, Colonel John C. Fremont had led a well-armed expedition there, supposedly to explore, but clearly meant to support, if not incite, a Texas-style rebellion. In mid-June 1846, a gaggle of Americans took the town of Sonoma in Northern California, tapped Fremont to lead them, and declared their independence 2 days before Commodore John Sloat arrived from Hawaii. He had been told a year earlier to take San Francisco, should war begin, and announced, without authority, California's annexation. The conquest appeared complete, but in September, Californios, Hispanic locals, struck back and took full control of much of Southern California. Even after Stephen Kearny arrived from New Mexico with a few hundred dragoons, he and Commodore Robert Stockton, who had replaced Sloat, had their hands full until Fremont joined them from up north. On January 13, 1847, a treaty with the Californios ended the resistance. By late February 1847, American forces had taken control over everything that Polk had wanted. But with Mexican popular opinion virulently against the gringos, Santa Anna's government showed no sign of capitulating. The decision was made to force the point by moving on the national capital. After directing the first large-scale amphibious landing in his nation's history, Major General Winfield Scott besieged and took the seemingly impregnable port city of Veracruz, bested Santa Anna's numerically superior force at the Battle of Cerro Gordo, and took the extraordinary risk of cutting loose from his support on the coast to lead more than 8,000 troops overland to Mexico City. He moved in stages over 4 months, allowing chances for his opponents to discuss terms, and arrived at the capital in August. Advancing unexpectedly from the south, Scott's force took the protective height of Chapultepec on September 13th. The next day, Santa Anna withdrew his troops, and the city surrendered. Except for some guerrilla assaults, the war was over. The peace, however, was more than 4 months away. The path to it was worried by the popular loathing of the Norte Americanos in Mexico, by its roulette of political affairs, and by the shifting of positions and opinions in Washington. Polk's negotiator, Nicholas Trist, first offered to pay almost what had been offered for areas originally sought, plus Baja California, and rights to the canal across Mexican lands. Santa Anna, once again president, declined. Polk, reminiscent of his upping his demands on the Oregon country, added demands for a sizable part of northern Mexico and ordered Trist to come home. Then Santa Anna was ousted again. When his replacement seemed more amenable, Trist, fearing with good reason that the situation might dissolve into chaos, chose to buck the president's order and press for a resolution. After protracted discussions and some amendments, an agreement was struck. An enraged Polk had Trist brought home in custody, but facing growing political turmoil, he followed Trist's reasoning and submitted the treaty. The Senate approved it on March 10, 1848, and the Mexican legislature on May 19th. The Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo, signed on February 2, 1848, acknowledged Texas's annexation and passed over to the United States all of today's California, Nevada, and Utah, as well as most of Arizona, western portions of Colorado, and New Mexico, and a tad of Wyoming. In return, the United States paid Mexico $15 million and assumed its debt to American citizens, now grown to a bit more than $3 million. Full citizenship was promised to all Mexican citizens who chose to relinquish their former allegiance. Washington agreed to control the Indian peoples on its side of the new border and to pay for damage that any inflicted in raids to the south, a commitment that proved full of problems and exceptionally expensive. costs of any war, in human and financial terms, are ultimately incalculable. But the official tally for the United States was more than 13,000 dead, most by far from disease, and close to $150 million in expenses in the field, in payments from the treaty, and in veterans' benefits over the years. With that, the land gorging of 1845 to 1848 was complete. And with the after-dinner mint of the Gadsden Purchase in 1853, the boundaries of the contiguous United States were set. It was quite a growth spurt. In only a little more time than between a child's birth and its speaking its first simple sentences, the United States expanded by 773,510,680 acres and change. Looking back on these events, it is easy enough to see them as serendipity, and for Mexico, its opposite. There were so many turns of chance that, if they had turned differently, would have likely derailed the course of expansion. So striking are the chains of chance that it is easy to miss a critical underlying point. While each moment was a proximate step in expansion, all were, at some remove, responses to pressures and interests that had been building for the previous few decades. Four in particular go a long way toward explaining not only expansion, but also the events that followed it. Begin with population. The number of Americans more than tripled between 1800 and 1840, from 5.3 million to 17 million. And even with the size of the nation doubling with the Louisiana Purchase, the density of population per square mile grew by 60%. While the economy was shifting toward early industrialization, most families engaged in agriculture or closely related enterprises. And with a high birth rate, each generation multiplied considerably the number of families hoping to start a farm. On the eve of expansion, the nation was increasingly crowded, at least by standards of the time, and basic math pushed the demand for land inexorably upward. Southern states could look beyond Louisiana and Arkansas to Texas, which by 1845 had a white population edging toward 100,000, plus about 30,000 enslaved Africans. Families in the Ohio Valley and around the Great Lakes could look to Michigan, Wisconsin, and Iowa. But the considerable land west of there was effectively off the agrarian table. This was Indian country. It had no political organization, had no effective connections to the East, and, it was thought, received too little rain for families to farm in accustomed ways. Plenty of land was still available in the Ohio Valley, but the rapid growth of population still prompted the impression that agricultural expansion might stall, as if running in place, which encouraged what was felt in the South, a scanning for places farther on that were friendly to farmers and their futures. Thus, Polk's twin appeal in 1844 in pledging to annex Texas and acquire Oregon. Reports from Oregon gushed over its agricultural potential, especially of the valley of the Willamette River, where the early booster Thomas Farnham described an arable corridor 150 miles long by 60 miles wide of rich vegetable mold 3 feet deep. In 1838, the era's great storyteller, Washington Irving, published a popular account of the party sent by John Jacob Astor to establish a post in 1811 to 1812. He reported a serene and delightful climate in coastal Oregon. One could sleep in the open air with perfect impunity and stand in the shade in high summer without breaking a sweat. As eastern farmlands filled, Oregon beckoned, and by 1844, a couple of thousand Americans had settled there, with more on the way, drawn by the prospect, in the phrase of the day, that if you planted a nail, it would come up a spike. A second demand was for commercial access to the Pacific world. Once Oregon was ours, John Fremont predicted in 1844, it would become a thoroughfare for the East India and China trade, that Senator John Calhoun was sure would funnel goods and wealth from half the people on the planet straight to the Mississippi Valley and beyond. The vision included California. 25 years before the United States acquired Oregon and California, a New England congressman assured his colleagues that once the swelling tide of Americans had reached the Pacific, the commercial wealth of the world is ours, and imagination can hardly conceive the greatness, the grandeur, and the power that awaits us. In the years ahead, a trade in sea otter furs and California cattle hides and a vigorous increase in whaling turn the interests of New Englanders increasingly to the Pacific coast and trade beyond it. Geography, however, posed a problem. Much of the Pacific coast consists of cliffs and heights, so interest came to focus on a handful of usable ports. In Oregon, the Fuca Strait and Puget Sound had several good harbors, but to the south were only Monterey, San Diego, and the Gem at San Francisco. The glory of the Western world, Farnham called its long, deep, wide, and placid bay. Even its bordering capes were verdant and refreshing to the eye. A third force was a quarter century of exploration of land to the west, the tracing of routes of transit, and the development of new means of moving across and around it. The first overland emigrants in 1841 took paths used over the previous 20 years by fur trappers. Over the following 5 years, Lieutenant John Charles Fremont of the Corps of Topographical Engineers led a series of ambitious expeditions that clarified the road to Oregon, established a route across the Sierra Nevada, described parts of the Great Basin in Central California, and reported on a trading route across the Southwest. His hugely popular official reports, written by his brilliant wife Jessie, were essentially enticements that left readers feeling, as historian William Getzman suggests, that James Polk's push westward was not just acceptable, but to many, inevitable. The marking of ways into the West coincided with a time when the nation and the world were, in practical terms, shrinking. New Englanders were especially interested in Pacific ports in part because new ship designs had shortened the effective distance between Boston and San Francisco, and between San Francisco and Hawaii and Hong Kong. By the 1840s, the canals that had redirected movement to the east were showing up in westering dreams. President Polk sought the rights to build one across the Isthmus of Tehuantepec. Texas expansionists proposed one to link Galveston and the Gulf of California. Two new technologies especially pushed along this revolution in movement. In May 1844, as Fremont was on his second expedition, Samuel Morse and Alfred Vail officially tested the telegraph system that would soon girdle the globe. A month earlier in New York, merchant Asa Whitney had arrived in San Francisco from more than a year in China. He was soon America's most impassioned advocate of the second technology, the railroad, as a link between the East, Pacific ports, and an Asian trade. 7 months after the Senate approved the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo, Fremont set out with 35 men to find a usable Pacific rail route across the Rocky Mountains. Washington sent Howard Stansbury to do the same up the Platte Road and through the Wasatch Mountains to Great Salt Lake. By then, the fourth development had given the vision of moving westward, quite literally, a distinctive coloration. There was a widely held conviction that expansion was both ordained and demanded by the nation's cultural and racial superiority. The world's peoples were arranged in a racial order, with Caucasians at the top and Anglo-Saxons at the top of them. The true homes of these superiors were Northern Europe, Germany, and especially England and the United States, places where, unsurprisingly, these theories began and flourished most. Descriptions of the Western land's beauty and promise were joined to others of peoples stunted in development and incapable of making of the country what God intended. In a small masterpiece of circular reasoning, Farnham described the elite Californios as men of not a very seemly bronze, then called them naturally indolent, offering as proof their lazy color. All of these impulses drew on and reinforced each other. Anglo-Saxon farmers needed Western land that, by happy chance, was properly theirs because retrograde Mexicans and Indians could never bring it to bloom. The railroads that promised to expand the nation's commerce and power were proof of its intellectual superiority and higher civilization. That, in turn, left Americans obligated to reach farther, into the Pacific. To Whitney, his rail line to the coast not only would benefit American farmers and merchants, but in time would also feed starving Chinese and bless the heathen, the barbarian, and the savage with civilization and Christianity. Expansion of 1845 to 1848 was both a child of chance and the product of forces that had been building for a quarter century. By 1845, those forces that come together under a gloss of confidence summed up in the term manifest destiny, that the United States was bound to dominate the lands between its current border and the Pacific. When the nation did in fact expand with such stunning speed, the sparks running through the stubble, it was natural to assume that what had brought the expansion would just as surely confirm America's command of the new country and its promised rise to new greatness. Every force behind expansion was, in fact, unloosed in the new America, and in time, expansion would indeed play vitally in the nation's steep rise in affluence and power. At the outset, however, that was anything but obvious. The events of 1845 to 1848 came close to destroying the Republic. Their first fruits were turbulence, uncertainty, and the most contentious and violent time in American history. The chapters that follow begin with that turbulent uncertainty. Part 1, Unsettling America, covers the first 17 years of the emergence of the West and its role in reconstructing the nation. The years were ones of growth and disordering, stunning revelations and unprecedented violence, continental fragmentation and disunion averted. Part 1 ends as the events of 1861 to 1865 that preserved the Union in the East began also to establish genuine command over the West, including the defeat, dispossession, and confinement of Indian peoples. The next 15 years or so saw the new nation consolidated as the Northeast and Southeast were tentatively rejoined and the West was brought fully into the nation. Part 2, Things Come Together, traces how spreading infrastructure and invigorated explorations were binding the West within itself and to the world beyond. It traces, too, how the West's role as a great laboratory in older and newer fields of science was expanding an understanding of the workings of the world, while justifying native dispossession and the fashioning of a new racial order. Part 3, Worked into Being, follows the story of how exploiting the West's prodigious resources continued to shape its contours of culture and power, even as it fed the needs and helped remake the nation's evolving economy. It is arranged by three familiar areas: ranching, agriculture, and mining. Not only because each was critical to Western development, but also because all were prime examples of the misconceptions that have clouded our appreciation of what was happening. Their romanticized images of crooning cowboys, sturdy homesteaders, and crusty sourdoughs picture the West as a place apart. In fact, ranching, farming, and mining all illustrated, and often pioneered, the new means of production, finance, and organization that after 1865 were increasingly evident elsewhere in the reconstructed nation. Each, too, was a prime case of how the working West was remaking America physically through environmental changes, ones as sweeping and often convulsive as any on Earth at the time, and was continuing as well to expand the grasp of global science. Two other threads run through the chapters. Every step of change affected Indian peoples, in virtually all cases, for the worse. It began with California genocide and proceeded through the progressive loss of lands and independence via treaty making and warfare, but above all through the repurposing of the land by the overwhelming numbers of new occupiers. Parallel to that unseating were efforts to determine just where native peoples fit within the human family and national household, a political concern that interlocked with African Americans in the East and Hispanos and Chinese in the West. Consigning the native story to its own chapter felt like creating a kind of textual reservation. Instead, it runs throughout, and it bears stressing in turn that the creation of the West, and certainly its moral meanings, cannot possibly be understood without it. The story of Indian peoples is wound together with the other thread. Apart from what actually happened, as best as we can recover it, the West's role in reconstructing America was, for want of a better term, mythic. All regions are montages of collective impressions. But those of the West, more than with those of, say, the South or New England, have been projections of the fantasies, aspirations, and anxieties of others. As the new country was unsettling the nation, the West was the projecting ground of the East's increasingly stark and violent divisions, which nearly destroyed the Continental Union. Once the crisis was resolved, the West's meanings reversed. Now its images and storylines, from belligerent Indians and insidious Chinese to railroads and stagecoaches, national parks and heroic geologists, spoke of a nation unified and redirected toward a common greatness and national character. In the final chapter, I have hoped to bring into some coherence the resistant sprawl of events from 1848 to the 1880s. It is meant to sum up the two themes mentioned at the start, the birth of a distinctive part of the nation, and how that birth was inherent to the nation's remaking, and its shift onto a fundamentally new path. The trick is keeping the two in a rough balance. Wallace Stegner was one of the most insightful and influential observers of the West. His admirers are especially fond of quoting his thought that the West has been America, only more so. Rarely, if ever, do they add what he wrote next. Actually, it is, and it isn't. Stegner understood that the West should be seen as an enlargement of the nation, its people, and its character. Yet it also has its own nature and its own story that deserves its own telling. When we recognize both and work to see how they fit together, we will be closer to understanding ourselves and how we have come to be. Part 1. Unsettling America. Expansion brought with it a long list of questions to answer and challenges to meet. The challenges began with the land itself. The eastern half of America offers no suggestion of its western half, a New England journalist wrote of the new country. Its mountains, deserts, savannas, and woodlands somehow had to be not only crossed and catalogued, but brought under some degree of physical command. That would have to begin with simply coming to know the place. Past a point quickly reached, the leaders of the nation had only the vaguest understanding of what they had just gotten. How the land lay, what was on and within it, and how it could and could not be put to the uses they wanted. The last question was especially pressing. Expansion's enthusiasts had crowed plenty about its economic promise, but what, in even the most general terms, did that mean? Most of the nation's working folk were farmers, but virtually nothing was known about where most of the new America could be farmed, what it could grow, and what methods had the slightest chances of success. Nor could anyone say what the West might offer for the nation's recent industrial stirrings, or what surprises, good and ill, it held in the pursuit of global markets, especially beyond the new border on the Pacific. What technologies would be needed to wring benefits from the land, starting with the means to connect its various parts and its workplaces, themselves yet unknown, and to stitch them into a national whole? The land was already well lived upon, and largely commanded by many tens of thousands of Indian people, divided among scores of different cultures. Yet the nation's leaders had only the most glancing knowledge of who they were, and where and how they lived, and the little information they had was comically, and it turned out tragically, distorted and naive. Precisely the same could be said about native people's view of the newcomers who were claiming their land. How would each deal with the other? That is, the basic course of relations among scores of centers of power across a third of the nation was wholly uncharted. There was, besides, a putative theocracy claiming control of a majority of the land taken from Mexico outside Northern California and New Mexico. And besides that, there were others who looked at the expanded America and wondered, why stop now? In 1855, the Secretary of War would complain that he had to deploy two-thirds of the Army's whole available force to prevent filibusters from launching into Mexico from California, New Mexico, and Texas. The faith that the United States had been ordained by God or history or the fates or whatever to expand to the Pacific, caught up in the phrase manifest destiny, supposedly held true for what would come next, the sure fulfillment of the land's promise as the nation perfected its command from coast to coast. As a predictor, however, that faith could not have been farther off the mark. In 1848, the future of what would become the West was more fluid and unsettled than it ever had been or would be. There was nothing destined about it. It was manifestly up for grabs. Still more treacherous questions were afoot. Even before the land had been formally acquired, expansion had begun to pry apart the Northeast and Southeast over a particularly dangerous issue from the past, whether Southeastern slave owners would be allowed to take their human chattel westward into lands under federal control. A political bargain in 1820 to 1821 had settled the issue for all lands inside the national boundaries in 1845. Then, the 3 years of explosive growth undid that bargain and began to stress the nation's political order, eventually beyond its snapping point. The remaking of the nation began when expansion unsettled it more profoundly than ever in its history. America at mid-century faced as many uncertainties, and ones as fundamental to its future, as at in any point in its history, and the attempts to cope with them set loose changes, east and west, as transformative as any that had come before or would come afterward. The continental unsettling culminated in 1861 in a continental crisis. The 4 years that followed, firmly seated in our memory, as ones that preserved the older republic, kept the new West as well within the nation. They also began to consolidate the new country, and truly to bring it in, along with its native peoples, fully into a national embrace. Expansion alone, however, cannot fully explain the transformations that followed. At almost the exact moment when the nation's three-part leap to the Pacific was formally finished, another sequence of events began that would quicken every question. Together, the paired episodes, the acquisitions to the Pacific, and that other chain of changes would create the West and would play a leading role in remaking the nation. The two came together one morning in early 1848, when a New Jersey carpenter looked down at his boots. 1. The Great Coincidence. When the first 49ers arrived in what was now the far edge of their expanded nation, the world was shifting under their feet. The shifting was not of historical forces, although that shift was real enough. It was not metaphorical, but literal. Like every place on Earth, California rides like a raft on top of an ocean of molten rock. That raft, the North American plate, moves westward at about an inch a year, and as it does, it runs against the Pacific plate, which comes at it at an angle. As the Pacific plate begins to slide onto California, more than 150 million years ago, the friction caused by the grinding melted part of its crust, which flowed upward as plumes of magma. Part erupted as a string of volcanoes, but most remained deep in the earth and cooled into a batholith, a giant body of granite. Then water and wind eroded away the volcanic mountains and the land around them, and as they did, the granite batholith gradually came into the light. This became the mountain range later named the Sierra Nevada. At first, it was no higher than today's Appalachians, but about 20 million years ago, the area to its east began to stretch east to west. As it did, the eastern edge of the Sierra rose sharply, some of it to 14,000 feet above the sea, while the land to its east dropped down. The result was what exhausted overland immigrants would find as they approached their journey's end, a steep mountain face they would have to labor up before cresting it and descending gradually into California's Central Valley. As the Sierra Nevada emerged, it brought with it a good bit of what humans for millennia have considered the very definition of wealth and beauty. Every ounce of gold on Earth has arrived as a space traveler. Gold is made from dying stars. It is born in a supernova, the explosion of an especially massive star, or the collision of two unimaginably dense neutron stars. It is flung into the void as space dust, some of which coalesces with other elements to become planets and other celestial objects. By far the most of the Earth's gold is in its molten core, hopelessly inaccessible. But some arrived about 200 million years after the planet's birth with a bombardment of some 20 billion billion tons of debris from meteors and asteroids. It was scattered and mixed unevenly into the Earth's crust as part of those floating rafts. Some was in considerable concentrations. A stretch of faulted rock on the Sierra Nevada, 150 miles long and 1 to 4 miles wide, held veins of gold-bearing quartz up to 50 feet wide and more than 1,000 feet long. A lot of gold remained in those veins, but a lot was freed as the land's endless erosion ate away at the Sierra. Gold is very inert. It combines with only a few other elements, and so it remained pure as it moved downhill in streams and eventually settled into the gravels of riverbeds. The streams came and went. Much of the eroded gold rested in the deep dry gravels of long-gone rivers. Some, however, was in the living watercourses that would be known by the first humans arriving at least 13,000 years ago, by the first Europeans coming in the 16th century, and 3 centuries later by Americans claiming the land as their destiny. Starborn, traveling billions of miles, churned deep into the earth and brought up with its mountains, then set loose to flow downward toward the sea. This gold, what Egyptians called the breath of God, lay beneath the water among rocks and pebbles, glittering, waiting to be seen. What is that? At the end of the U.S.-Mexico War, Lieutenant William Tecumseh Sherman was in Monterey, California, an aide to Colonel Richard B. Mason, the military governor. One morning in the spring of 1848, 2 men walked into his office and asked to speak privately to Mason. A few minutes later, the governor called in Sherman and pointed to some glittering specks and pebbles the men had laid on a table. "What is that?" Mason asked. Sherman had seen gold mined in northwestern Georgia, and now he tried a couple of simple tests, noting the metallic luster of the flakes and bending them with his teeth to check their malleability. "They were the real item," he said. The men left. Weeks passed. In July, Sherman accompanied Mason to the area along the American River where the gold had been found. And what he saw left him quite bewildered. About 4,000 men were laboring uncomplaining under a brutal sun and knee-deep in frigid water, buying overpriced supplies in brush-hut stores and sleeping on the ground under layers of pine needles. Mason was just as wide-eyed in the formal report he sent to the War Department a month later. Men were finding gold in $80 chunks, and 2 had cleared $10,000 in a week. All the area's rivers, the Yuba, Feather, Bear, and others, he believed to be equally promising. The following December, President James Polk told Congress that officers in the public service, that would be Mason and Sherman, had confirmed by facts on the spot the tantalizing rumor heard over the past months. Gold was abundant across a wide swath of the country just acquired from Mexico. Things were happening fast, he reported. San Francisco's manhood, storekeepers and stevedores, liverymen, clerks, lawyers and layabouts, lots of soldiers and nearly all its sailors, had lit out for the mines. Goods and labor commanded preposterous prices. By the time Sherman left California in 1850, he could see that the discovery he had helped confirm had set loose a folk movement that would repeople the far edge of the continent. So it happened that the man who, as much as any other, would determine the outcome of the Civil War, also had a hand in the event that, as much as any other, would create the West and shift the nation's history. The upheaval began at a mill site. James W. Marshall, a carpenter and builder, had drifted westward from New Jersey, first to Oregon and then to California, where he served under John Charles Fremont and then worked for John Sutter, grantee of nearly 50,000 acres bordering the American River east of San Francisco. As 1848 opened, he was overseeing construction of a sawmill in partnership with Sutter. The mill race needed deepening. To gouge it out with minimal labor, Marshall had ordered a temporary dam built and then opened several times to flush through the mill site. On the morning of January 24th, he was inspecting the results. He looked down into the exposed gravel and noticed a sparkle. He stooped into the shallows and gathered a few flecks. First on his own and then with Sutter, Marshall did a simple assay, hammering his find with rocks, boiling it with lye, and applying nitric acid. Convinced it was gold, Sutter sent a sample to Governor Mason to secure title to the strike. The visit Sherman witnessed, but Mason demurred. The land was in legal limbo, he said, conquered but without civil authority. Sutter then tried to suppress the news, but workers at the mill tossed their shovels and saws and with just about everyone else in the vicinity, were soon looking for gold up and down the river and in nearby streams. Word soon leaked to San Francisco, with the consequent jumbling of tents and brush huts Sherman and Mason found on their visit. For anybody at that time claiming that the fates were favoring the United States, Marshall's discovery of gold might have been Exhibit A. Just 9 days after he noticed the glitter at his feet, the treaty was signed that made the mill site, and around it the region soon called the Motherlode, part of the nation. Within 200 hours of it becoming part of the Republic, that is, California began to be revealed as the most valuable real estate on the continent. The first flake Marshall picked up was worth about $0.50. When Mason visited the American River the following July, he estimated miners were clearing between $30,000 and $50,000 a day. Strike followed strike. By 1854, the nation's gold production had increased 73 times over. California's output, plus that of Australia, which had its own strike in 1851, exceeded that of everywhere on Earth during the previous 356 years since the Columbian landfall. California's production of $65 million in its banner year of 1852 was greater than that of all the world's gold mines during the entire 18th century. By 1900, its output since Marshall's half dollar was estimated at $1.4 billion. A sardonic Marshall, understandably, had his own take on the figures. Of the profits derived from the enterprises, it stands thus, he wrote in 1857. Yankeedom, $600 million. Myself individually, $0. Anyone needing a more kinesthetic image to appreciate those numbers might consider this. In 1856, the San Francisco Mint was processing so much gold that considerable amounts were blown out its smokestack. Investigators found gilded rooftops 100 yards distant. The effects rippled outward, even farther. Markets boomed up and down the Pacific coast and around its rim as countries from Chile to Australia poured goods into California. And as word reached the Atlantic, manufacturers and shippers as far away as Norway began to eye it as a potential market. The impact of gold itself was seismic. Global prices surged, manufacturing capital doubled, and the exploding supply of money found its way into enterprises from French wheat farms to railroads and the Sardinian telegraph. In the year of the discovery, an amateur economist had published some thoughts on the relationship of labor and capital. 10 years later, the impact of California and Australian gold had so shaken society that he felt compelled to re-examine his ideas in light of this new stage of development. In 1867, Karl Marx published Das Kapital. Gold's initial jolt, however, had a far tighter radius. Someone sailing from New York in 1848 could get to India faster than to San Francisco, while the trip from California to Tasmania was weeks shorter than to Washington, D.C. Consequently, it was 11 months before President Polk officially confirmed the stunning news, and another 7 or 8 before the first gold seekers from the Atlantic coast arrived in California. When they got there, they found that thousands of others had been pulling money from the earth for months. Before the 49ers, there were 48ers. Everyone around him seemed to have gone insane, apparently living in a dream, John Sutter's Gardner wrote of the mobs that suddenly crowded the banks of the American River and its tributaries. Colonel Mason figured that more than half of the 4,000 men he saw were Indians from local tribes, working the streams with tightly woven willow baskets. Most at first were probably conscripted by Sutter and others, or working as drudge laborers paid with food, crude shelter, and gewgaws of trifling value. But once they learned what gold would bring in the local stores, many turned independent and soon were sporting the results. Pants and vests, scarves, gaudy shawls. Heretofore, so poor and degraded, Mason wrote, they have suddenly become consumers of the luxuries of life. Some turned to prospecting and discovered several of the most valuable early deposits. Word seeped out to San Francisco in late April, and although editors tried to stem the flow, calling the rumors a sham, got up to guzzle the gullible. The stampede was on. Rowboats that had cost $50 now went for $500, dollar shovels for $10. In late May, word reached Monterey, reportedly preceded by omens, a white raven playing with a child, owls ringing church bells. Prospectors heading north stripped the city of every bowl, tray, warming pan, and piggin, everything, in short, that has a scoop in it that will hold sand and water. Oregon heard the news in early August. Harvest was only weeks away, but as a local versified, the farmer's left his plow and steers, the merchant left his measure, the tailor dropped his goods and shears, and went to gather treasure. By various reports, two-thirds of Oregon's adult males left for California, leaving only five elderly men in Salem and in Oregon City, nothing but women, children, and Indians. By then, a wider immigration was underway. Late in the previous century, Hawaiian natives called Kanakas had begun working as trappers in the Northwest, and when a ship brought news of gold to Honolulu, 5 months to the day after Marshall's find, as many as 3,000 were sailors on ships around the Pacific. Within weeks, hundreds more, virtually all foreign-born men, had left the islands for California. The evaporating labor pool drove wages to new heights. Considerably more gold seekers came via well-worn routes from Sonora and other Mexican border states. The French consul at Monterey wrote in May of 1848 that 10,000 had passed by. Chile and Peru received word in late summer, and over the winter virtually every available vessel, including whalers, were shuttling to San Francisco passengers and cargoes of picks, shovels, boots, mirrors, shaving brushes, and whatever might sell. An estimated 5,000 Chileans were in the hills by June. Australia was in a depression when news arrived just before Christmas, and the exodus of gold seekers sent the price of houses tumbling even more. Tasmanians gathered around street placards, gold, gold, and who's for California? After their first cruise deserted to the goldfields, captains from down under began hiring New Zealand Maoris, figuring they were more likely to stay aboard for the voyage home. The 48ers laid down the early basics of California mining. Hispano locals, and especially Mexicans and South Americans, could draw on generations of mining experience. They tutored others in locating and extracting the most available dust. To process it, they used mercury from nearby cinnabar deposits that, by another stroke of remarkable luck, had been discovered in the 1820s. Influences from outside California soon became part of the texture of daily life. The brightly colored Mexican banners and flags displayed in one camp reminded an earlier visitor of Asian bazaars. Hawaiians strolled about in colorful shirts and silk sashes, Chileans in distinctive wide belts and black ponchos, Indians in military coats, but no pants. Already gambling was pervasive, and most popular was Monte, the Mexicans' great national game, that one man claimed they would play in bed, on horseback, on their dinner plate, or their father's corpse. Eventually, it would spread throughout the West. Women in street stalls sold Mexican-style meat rolled in tortillas, which was popular with the more acclimated, but later avoided by Easterners for its lower-class connotation, and especially for its dramatic seasoning. A visitor in the 1870s added a red pepper, the size of a minnow, to her salad, took a bite, and shades of Vulcan. Tears would not have flowed more freely if I had taken a coal of fire into my mouth. The principal sources of heat are said to be the sun, the fixed stars, chemical action, and electricity. But I am the first person who has ever discovered a latent hell in a red pepper. I would warn all persons to beware of the pepper family entire. Later arrivals picked up and adapted Mexican songs, a catchy musical phrase in "Donde vas, bueno caballero?" Where are you going, good sir? Became the chorus of "My Darling Clementine." A Western cultural artifact was born. 48ers established one of the West's prime characteristics. From that point on, the region would be the most culturally and ethnically mixed part of the nation. From Oregon to Arizona to the Dakotas, that human variety would enliven Western society and quicken its development by bringing ideas and customs from virtually every part of the planet. it would also add immeasurably to the stresses that would soon make the emerging West one of the most violent places in the nation's history. The sheer pace of changes, plus the lustrous possibilities they unveiled in California and elsewhere in the region, naturally twisted ever tighter the usual tensions among disparate people thrown together. They would rupture within months when the next wave of gold seekers, the 49ers, washed into the country from the east. That wave began to build only in the final months of 1848, but once it did, it swelled extravagantly. In yet another anticipation of a Western theme, distance and sheer ignorance about the new country seemed to inflate hopes and fantasies. An early best-selling pamphlet, claiming first-hand experience, but made from scant reports and lies, described a land of fertile soil, warm, perfumed breezes, welcoming people, and terrain so friendly one could go by carriage from San Francisco to the mines as if riding down Broadway in Manhattan. Gold was everywhere. Approaching Sutter's Land, the author's party stopped to dip a drink from a stream, and lo, at the bottom of the cup we found sparkling grains of gold. The day after Christmas of 1848, James Gordon Bennett's New York Herald, the nation's most widely circulated newspaper, published the first of four special editions of the California Herald. They included maps, information on routes, and plenty about the glorious promise of the diggings. Philadelphia's Christian Observer assured readers that gold lies on the open plain, in the shadows of the deep ravines, and glows on the summits of the mountains. Newspapers across the country, and especially in the Midwest, picked up the refrain during the first months of 1849. Hunt's Merchants Magazine and Commercial Review gave instructions on gold panning, adding offhandedly that men were regularly returning from the mines bent down by 100 pounds of gold dust apiece. Advertisements included a detector of the precious metal, Signor Dalvier's goldometer, and California gold grease to be smeared over the body before rolling down hills to pick up the glittering powder that lay all across the landscape. As for getting out to El Dorado, some proposals were an equal stretch of credibility. An editor of the Scientific American, Rufus Porter, suggested an aerial locomotive, an 800-foot steam-powered dirigible that would carry 200 passengers and their baggage on a smooth 3-day flight from New York to California. Grizzly bears would gape in wonder far below, Porter predicted, as observers in Europe marveled at America's soaring enterprise. Earthbound gold seekers had to stick to traditional options. Ships began leaving eastern ports for California early in 1849, and by late winter, towns along the Missouri River were filling with crowds intent on an early start for an overland journey to the Pacific. With dreams of their own mercantile gold rush, Independence, Westport, and St. Joseph in Missouri, and Canesville, Iowa, vied to become the preferred jumping-off place. Each boasted superior access to the trail west, the best and cheapest draft animals, and the most reliable liveries, farriers, dry goods merchants, flour mills, wagon makers, wheelwrights, and saddle and harness makers. Leaving before May was chancy, given the plain's unpredictable spring weather and the need for the grass to be up and hardy enough to feed their oxen, and impatient overlanders waited out the calendar in crowded tent cities. The build-up made a bottleneck of the first step of the trip, crossing the Missouri. On May 3rd, a man wrote his sister from St. Joseph of 300 to 400 wagons in line to be ferried, a wait of 3 days, maybe four. Once over the river, the immigrant gathering looked westward across more than 2,000 miles of what they knew only by rumor and leaps of fancy. What followed was a microcosm of how the West would be shaped over the decades ahead. It anticipated the longer transformations to the land and its peoples, including devastations and assaults on tens of thousands who were bound to the place by centuries of intimacy. The more immediate picture was of outlanders coming into the country, older lives brought into new worlds, bearing the past, yet startled and changed by what they found. A shout westward. It was as if everyone living in Michigan and Arkansas in 1840 together picked up and walked west. Between then and 1860, more than 300,000 persons would trek overland to California, Oregon, and Utah, most of them to gold country. More than 250,000 more would travel from the East Coast to San Francisco by sea between 1849 and 1860, crossing via Panama and Nicaragua, while thousands more would take the longer route around Cape Horn. Joining them were tens of thousands of persons from Europe. Just how many flocked to the Pacific coast is a speculation, but the mass migration was certainly one of the largest and most diverse in modern history. It was also an anticipation. Like so much in the next 30 years, the overlander experience both reflected American life at large and displayed the utter strangeness of the new world it was moving into. Immigration by sea was by two routes. Nearly 16,000 persons sailed around Cape Horn, a voyage of 6 to 8 months. The speed and quality of experience varied considerably. One voyager languished miserably in an old-fashioned tub of a vessel that was slower than justice. The second way, via Panama, soon proved more popular. The first arrivals from the East came by that route. Only 29 passengers were on the steamship Falcon as it left New York City for Panama on December 1, 1848, 4 days before Polk's gold-confirming message. By the time the ship stopped in New Orleans, the word had arrived by telegraph, and nearly 200 men clamored aboard and refused to leave. Passengers crossed from Chagres on Panama's east coast to Panama City on the other side. The steamship California carried the first of them to San Francisco, 365 passengers, 100 above its supposed capacity, and more than all persons taken to Panama the previous year. By year's end, between 5,000 and 6,000 men had followed the first comers. Twice as many took the Panama route the next year. Chagres was a primitive town of bamboo huts along muddy streets full of naked children and lank dogs. Its few accommodations were strained impossibly by the eruption of Americanos. Antsy for the gold fields, they took an ancient trail across the isthmus. The trip began in canoes called bongos, paddled by locals to the villages of Cruces and Gorgona near the peak of the Atlantic watershed. After resting and dining on mule steaks, dead pork, and iguana pie, travelers went the rest of the way in the saddle, sloshing through swamps down a trail lined by dead and putrefying mules. Panama City was a traditional Spanish town with a decaying fort and whitewashed houses with roofs of red tile. It was only 9 degrees north of the equator, 21 degrees closer than Boston, and 16 closer than even New Orleans, and the searing sun alternating with curtains of rain left the unacclimated feeling as if they were living in a dog's mouth. "The climate of the isthmus proved very trying," wrote one, a little daintily. "The air failed to satisfy the lungs. Diseases, especially cholera, malaria, and yellow fever, flourished in the deplorable sanitation and tropical climate. Some waited weeks for a spot on a northbound ship. The Price's ticket bought a bed in a stateroom and meals of beef, duck, lamb, cheese, and fruit. But the great majority crowded together in steerage, seething, swaying, quarreling, and cursing, sleeping on shelves and eating salt pork and black bread served out of tubs on deck. A voyage of 20 to 30 days brought them to San Francisco." For all its discomforts, the Panama route was far and away the fastest, and what had been scarcely a trickle of traffic before 1849, mostly officials and missionaries, swelled to more than 26,000 by 1855. It jumped still more the next year, when completion of a railroad, truly the first transcontinental, eased the crossing toward the goldfields and elsewhere around the Pacific. The overland route was far slower, but it was by far the cheapest way to go. Before 1849, about 19,000 had made the crossing. About 60% went to Oregon, drawn by accounts of land of plenty and of astonishing fertility, and about 25% had come with the early Mormon exodus to the Great Salt Lake in 1847 and 1848. The rest, only about 1 in 6, went to California, most to John Sutter's Grant. Marshall's gold changed that. In 1849 and 1850, nearly 80,000 persons journeyed overland, more than four times the total of the previous 8 years, with nearly 9 in 10 landing in California, and nearly 65,000 followed during the next 2 years. The flow then slackened, only to jump again on the eve of the Civil War with discoveries of silver in what would be Virginia City, Nevada. In 1849, about 5,000 persons followed the Gila River route to Santa Fe, and then across the southwestern deserts to Southern California. But most crossed by the Platte River route. From various towns along the Missouri River, they converged on Platte, in what is now east central Nebraska, and moved along the south bank before ascending the river's north fork to the Continental Divide at South Pass, a broad saddle between the northern and middle Rocky Mountains. Some would then branch off to the northwest to Oregon, while the California bound would take a southwesterly route across the Great Basin, following the Humboldt River until it sank into the earth, and then crossing 40 miles of desert before ascending the Truckee and Carson Rivers to the Sierra Nevada. Unlike the Rockies, the Sierra had no easy gateway. In the journey's final and most difficult stage, immigrants urged their spent oxen over Donner or Roller Pass before laboring down the western side. From start to finish, the trip was quite a physical test. Anyone crossing, warned a veteran, would endure heat like a salamander, mud and water like a muskrat, dust like a toad, and labor like a jackass. Another swore that he would swim around Cape Horn on a log before making the overland trip again. Simply as a human experience, the overland migration was one of the most distinctive episodes of American history, and a fitting prelude to the creation of the West. The travelers' responses to the land and to each other anticipated those across the region for the rest of the century, as did the appalling consequences for the land and its native peoples. The 2,000-mile trip from the Missouri River to California or Oregon at first took 4 to 6 months, though over time improvements shortened the time. One man made it to California in an astounding 76 days. A typical day's travel of 10 to 15 miles began before dawn, with camp broken and breakfast cooked. In the middle came 2 or 3 hours of nooning for a meal and to rest the animals. Travel ended close to dusk, with a new camp yet to be made, animals pastured, and dinner prepared. Most walked most of the way, and by the end their clothes showed the costs. My skirts were worn off in rags above my ankles, a woman recalled. My sleeves hung in tatters above my elbows. Around my neck was tied a cotton square, torn from a discarded dress. The grueling pace, repeated week upon week, was exhausting, although at day's end some found the experience inspiring. "Love is hotter here than anywhere that I have seen," one traveler wrote. "When they love here, they love with all their might, and sometimes a little harder." Within a couple of 100 miles, emigrants found themselves in an increasingly alien world. Addison Crane marveled at the wildest and most magnificent scenes, but then he gave up. Anyone who should seriously attempt its description could only make a fool of himself. The West's openness and its yawning skyscape could leave outlanders feeling swallowed by space. The impression of sameness, of an ocean of land, the same day in and day out, could be unnerving. When a young man asked his toddler sister why she was crying, she answered that, "We will never get to Oregon if we come back and camp in the same place every night." Travelers were stunned at erratic swings of weather, like going to sleep in Nebraska and awaking in Siberia, one wrote, and at the ferocity of storms with sheets of fire, pouring rain and the bellowing thunder, and hail, as if a field of ice had been put through a crusher and then rained down upon us. In high summer, they marveled at mirages, as heat and refracted light showed them lakes that weren't there, and lifted distant wagons into the shimmering air, so they dipped and swayed like sloops at sea. The Western menagerie drew plenty of interest. Antelopes, more properly pronghorns, glided over the prairie at a bird's wing pace. Bison drew the closest attention. One woman called a bull a prairie god, with enough hair on its chin for a dozen French emperors. Travelers approached the trip with fears of lurking predators, but the anxieties were baseless. Stretches of the trail fairly writhed with rattlesnakes. One party killed 14 under their wheels as they fled a camp. But bites were extremely rare, and the record has no cases of attacks by bears, wolves, and other creatures of eastern nightmares. Native residents often were lumped with other exotic fauna. "We have seen no wild animals except Indians, lizards, and black-tailed hares," wrote a diarist in Nevada. As with animals, families often set out fearing that ruthless savages were waiting along the trails, as patient as spiders, ready to pounce. One mother cropped her daughter's hair to discourage scalping. Another carried pellets of cyanide in a locket to take if facing rape. The closest study, however, shows only 3 overlanders out of every 2,000 killed by Indians, and considerably more Indians killed by whites than vice versa, 426 to 362 between 1840 and 1860. Indians typically approach with overtures, not arrows. When about 60 Lakota hunters met David DeWolfe's party along the North Platte in 1849, the lead horseman came forward with a flag crudely inscribed with the stars and stripes. "They were very friendly and understood begging," he wrote. But like other native visitors, these were likely asking for a courtesy or for compensation for the loss of vital resources. There were occasional thefts of supplies or horses, but most meetings were of mutual curiosity and of exchanges of everything from moccasins and hats to feathers and hoop skirts. A delegation of Cheyenne was bored by a fiddle and watch, they had seen plenty, but quite taken with a jew's harp and amber types of distant families. The true threats were ones of the overlander's own making. In peak years, campgrounds could be nearly as crowded as urban slums. As hundreds of parties stopped in the same places night after night, the garbage, offal, and human and animal waste quickly mounted. So by season's end, the route was as much a gutter as a trail. An obvious result was, with accidents, one of the 2 most common causes of death, disease. Contact diseases passed person to person flourished on the first 500 miles or so before burning themselves out. Chronic ailments, dysentery the most common, persisted all the way. Their monotonous diet starved travelers of essential vitamins and left them vulnerable to scurvy once they arrived in California. Some disorders, notably mountain fever, transmitted via ticks, were picked up en route. Cholera was the greatest killer. A bacterial intestinal infection passed usually by fouled water. It produces high fever, stomach cramps, and effulgent diarrhea that wrings the body of its fluids. Death can come within a day of the first symptoms, sometimes less. Cholera had last visited North America in 1832, but by grim luck it arrived in New York and New Orleans in December 1848, just as Polk was formally recognizing California's gold fields, and it swept up the Mississippi just in time for 49ers to pick it up and carry it onto the trail. It struck again in 1852, the year of the heaviest migration to California. Physicians did the best they could. One treated more than 700 patients, but the losses could be horrific. One immigrant wrote of a train of 11 wagons, all driven by women. Every man had died. An Arkansan wrote in 1852, "Huffmaster and wife and Manorat are dead. Uncle Enos is dead. James Hanen and wife and child are dead. Craig and wife and child are dead. James Crawford's babe is dead. David's child is dead. And Samuel Hanen has been at the point of death, but was on the mend. Nancy Graham and William Ingram's children are both dead. Elvie Hanen is delirious and is an object to look at. Jacob Rush's widow and little girl are dead." The other prime threat was accidents. Especially before toll bridges and ferries, emigrants drowned crossing the Platte and Green Rivers and floating down the Columbia. About as common were deaths by accidental gunshots from rifles and pistols kept primed and sometimes cocked at the ready for dangers that weren't there. Children, spending their energies clambering in and out of wagons, were especially prone to falling and being crushed under the wheels. Injuries normally non-fatal, such as a cut or broken bone, stood a fair chance of worsening by infection, sometimes to the point of death, under the physical exhaustion and dietary limits of the trip. Too often the dead were so hastily and shallowly buried that wolves and coyotes pulled them out and ate them, leaving bones scattered along the trail sides, which one traveler called a vast city of the dead. While only informed guesses are possible, the total losses between 1840 and 1860 were between 14 and 20,000, which has the mortality rate between 4 and 6%, higher than that for the general population back home, and considerably higher than a sampling of young adults. It was quite a toll, especially when imagined as an average of 7 to 10 graves per mile. The overland trails anticipated the emerging West in another way, their environmental impact. Rapid, intense, wrenching, and catastrophic for native human and faunal populations. The popular image is of swaying wagons passing single file across a great empty space. In fact, in the busiest years, the traffic could resemble that in central Boston or Philadelphia. Wagons sometimes traveled 12 abreast. Tens of thousands of iron-rimmed wheels and millions of animal hooves tore at the soil and left a rutted road that in places was hundreds of yards across. The steady wind whipped the pulverized earth into choking clouds. Eyes stung, clothing itched, all food crunched. There were occasional advantages. When a young girl fell under her wagon and its wheel passed over her head, the dust was so deep she was simply pressed down into it. She jumped up asking, "Am I killed?" Oxen overgrazed what had been rich swards of grasses until by summer's end the only pasture was a mile or more off the trail. The Platte Valley had hosted great stands of timber, but by the mid-1850s virtually all were gone, except some cedars well up feeder canyons. By then the overlanders' entry to the West was a metaphor for much of the land's later story, a mess of their own making. The experience was, in other ways, a continuity, a carrying forward of lives left behind, starting with a sense of community. Many came as companies reflecting their origins. The Wolverine Rangers, Buckeye Rovers, Newark Overland Company, and Boston Newton Company. Migrants from all sections of the country were coming together where sectional tensions were tightest in the 1850s, Eastern Kansas. Yet there was no record of serious conflict in the bivouacs. Once underway, companies helped each other find stray stock, repair wagons, feed the foodless, nurse the sick, and bury the dead. A young girl caring for an infant whose mother had died en route would seek out a wet nurse at each night's campground over the final 500 miles. She was never refused. There were predictable fractures among the rolling communities. A diarist wrote of a pair in his group who had started out together. Duggan and Dooner, not being able to agree, made a division, sawing their wagon in two and making each a cart. But in light of these stresses endured over the miles and months, the general mood was remarkably positive. "Never have I seen so much hospitality and good feeling," wrote one overlander, who had enjoyed coffee, warm biscuits, and butter in a neighboring camp the previous evening. Travelers quickly grasped a lesson of much of Western settlement ahead, even at its most competitive. Cooperation paid. People brought other cultural fundamentals with their oxen and butter churns. Nothing showed this more clearly than families and how they operated. Their very absence highlighted their importance. More than 90% of those crossing in 1849 were men, with a portion even higher among the California-bound. Forced suddenly into women's work, many floundered pathetically. A diary of a later overland traveler to Colorado's goldfields shows a culinary nightmare of raw, fat meat, dried beef, and crackers. By the trip's end, he was "never half so hungry in my life. Oh, flesh pots of Edgept, how I sigh for ye." The double load of work was grueling. They had to repair all breaks, wash and mend their own clothes, bake their own cakes, cook their own meat, brown and boil their own coffee. A months-long tutorial in a home economy most had taken for granted. By 1853, the numbers were righting themselves. The portion of male overlanders dropped to 66%, and one out of five on the trail was a child. Migration became more like what it had been before 1849, a family affair, and wives, husbands, children, and others stayed grooved in customary behaviors. Most women wore long, full skirts, perhaps from modesty in bodily functions along the crowded, treeless trails. They hauled out furniture at the end of the day and set it up in a home-like way and went calling from wagon to wagon for what one called feminine diversions. Children, called by one authority, respecters, even venerators of customs, carried their own traditions, a body of games, lore, rhymes, and language that in some cases dated back centuries. Along the Truckee and Platte rivers, they played How Many Miles to Miley Bright, a rhyming game born of medieval English pilgrimages. Rituals persisted. The most hurried funerals observed a few fundamentals and offered a hymn or two, and the rare marriage might be followed by a shivery, with a crowd shooting guns and banging pans, enough to awaken the seven sleepers outside the wagon of bedded newlyweds. Lines of authority held firm. As the men in her company plotted the day's travel, Sarah Royce wrote, the women were busy cooking, washing, mending up clothes, etc. The exception came on the Sabbath, as impatient men wanted to keep rolling, and women, keeper of the family's moral life, wanted to stop. They had a more mundane reason for observing the Sabbath. They needed the rest. Everybody on the trail worked hard, but they did not work hard at the same things. Men's traditional work in fields and shops was suspended on the trail, but much of women's labors in seeing to a family's needs continued, and under especially trying circumstances. Some had worked for weeks before leaving, drying fruit and preparing what they could in advance. And once underway, they made more, as well to cover the extra calories burned in the long trudge. In effect, there were four or five meals a day. The mountain man and guide, James Clyman, watched a woman stand in a driving rain for 2 hours, holding an umbrella as she fried bread. Women mended clothes and did laundry in muddy rivers. Mothers fed, nursed, and bathed children. A typical family traveled with three or four, while caring for them in the baking heat of crowded, jolting wagons. While some children were lost along the way to accidents and disease, some were added. Remarkably, the birth rate on the trails apparently was a bit above the national average, with roughly one woman out of eight bearing a child during the trip. These couples obviously knew that a child was on the way, and that at some point on the journey, under primitive conditions and almost surely far from a doctor, and likely without another woman experienced in midwifery, the wife would enter into the most dangerous thing a woman in those years could do, give birth. Perhaps this measures an allure of the new country strong enough to overbalance the most compelling reasons not to go, or at least to wait. Perhaps it reflects the family as patriarchy, with husbands overruling pregnant wives' objections to setting off, or perhaps childbirth was considered such a natural recurring turn in the familial cycle that it should be taken, literally in this case, in stride. Whatever the explanation, two points are clear. Fundamental patterns of life in the East persisted, and as that life was borne westward by the hundreds of thousands crossing the continent, the patterns wore more heavily on women than on men. There were plenty of lighter moments, also reflecting the cultural transfer. Went swimming, read four chapters of Proverbs, part of As You Like It, shot at a mark five times, ate supper, and went to bed, a man wrote. And a woman did not know when I have enjoyed anything so thoroughly, after she and a friend read aloud the poem Locksley Hall. Frank Langworthy read his way westward by drawing on the plains library, books others had tossed by the road. Along the Arkansas, a man heard from a nearby camp airs by Mozart, strangely out of place in the wild waste, and a woman was awakened by soldiers singing a chorus from The Barber of Seville. There were impromptu dances and contests. At one stop, a company made ice cream. Mozart and dessert, half-devoured corpses and country beyond description. The journey was a rough metaphor for a larger experience. Taking control of the country would always be a process of cultural sift, and it started with the act of walking into it. As the miles unrolled, and the oxen tired, and as immigrants gradually grasped what they were in for, there began a recalculation of needs, hopes, and sentiments. Within a few weeks, a sloughing began, and past the Rockies, as true exhaustion set in, the trail was littered with clothing, cook stoves, plows, anvils, furniture, firearms, and at least one iron safe and a diving bell. And just so in the years ahead. Those settling into the new country would toss aside other cargo, thoughts of the possible, identities, oughts and shoulds, while holding tenaciously to other presumptions and imposing them onto the new lives they were making. One thing set the journey to the far west apart. It was one of two mid-century episodes, the other being the Civil War, in which hundreds of thousands of Americans were suddenly and wrenchingly tossed into experiences utterly alien to their lives until then. Unlike heading for the battlefield, however, the trip to the Pacific included persons of both sexes and all ages. Never in the nation's history has there been such a massive collective gawk. There were vast mounded communities of critters that looked like squirrels, but yipped like dogs, and scavenged human skulls at trailside, some still with hair and ribbons. There were hammering storms that upended whole wagons as electricity crackled around their iron wheel rims. Travelers drank water so thick with silt that we could almost pick it up with our fingers, and met brightly sprightly Indian children, some bedecked in white buckskin, and other in puris naturalibus. Those crossing Panama and Nicaragua had their own memories. They told of trees draped in snakes, cigar-smoking children, freshwater sharks, and lizards the size of small dogs. A New Yorker attended a wake for a one-year-old boy, whose corpse stood at the center of the room, dressed in a spangled robe and crowned with a flowered wreath. Only the mother appeared to grieve. Beside her sat a blind fiddler, his eyes rolling side to side as he sawed away. A gay crowd drank rum and danced around the dead child, whose open eyes were cast slightly down, as if he were in deep thought. 2. Division and Multiplication. The westward flocking was a display of broader realities in national life. It reflected and amplified long simmering tensions between Northeast and Southeast. It also spawned other, offsetting forces that quickly began to bind the emerging West into the evolving nation. The two themes, the West as divider, the West as unifier, would play out through the next three decades. So would another development, begun by the Great Coincidence. By the end of the 1850s, California's economy showed a maturity rivaling that of many eastern states. Its vitality would quicken the nation's turn into the Pacific world and would help propel a far wider economic growth that, in time, would help pull a diverse America into one and set it on a new course. A nation divided and connected. Northeast and Southeast had contested visions of what the West should be in its economic and cultural basics, and each tried vigorously to cultivate its particular views. In that contest, the Southeast might seem to have had a definite edge. Only 33 years after the Louisiana Purchase of 1803, Southern expansion had birthed a new nation, the Republic of Texas, and carried tens of thousands of persons beyond the nation's southwestern border. The push out of the Northeast, meanwhile, had been less than feeble. There was vigorous settlement in Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Iowa, but beyond that was Indian country, and farther on, past the northwestern boundary that would become the state of Washington, Oregon, Idaho, and Montana, contained at most a few dozen American citizens. Texas's independence kicked Southern expansionism into a more vigorous stage. Texas claimed, based on virtually nothing, that its western boundary was the Rio Grande, which would have given it Santa Fe, and in 1841 it sent an expedition to take command. It failed miserably, but Texan visions only expanded. By one scheme, a link by rail, steamboat, and canal would allow a 10-day passage from New Orleans through Texas to Guaymas on the Gulf of California. From there, Texans could converse with the people of China through a speaking trumpet. Legislators further resolved that the Republic now included the Mexican states of Chihuahua, Sonora, and Upper and Lower California, plus parts of four others, altogether half of the neighboring nation. Denial of their preposterous claim was an insufferable affront. Jesus could be composed under insult, wrote a prominent attorney, but the people of Texas are of a different breed. The south-to-west thrust persisted into the 1850s, and in the earliest stages of the gold rush, the southeast was strongly represented. The considerable numbers of its people might seem to feed the hope that California would become a slave-based economy and culture, from its mines to the fields that would feed the miners. Looking strictly at the previous decades, that might seem a natural outcome. But the dynamic of America's westward tilt was fast changing. The shift was most obvious in the old Northwest. Illinois and Iowa quadrupled in population between 1840 and 1860. Indiana and Michigan tripled. Wisconsin residents increased 25 times over, 30,945 to 775,881. The previous southern thrust of expansion was shifting sharply to the north, and the pressure to expand yet farther west was shifting with it. A series of interlocking developments fueled that change. One was a tightening economic connection between the Ohio Valley and states to its east and north. In the past, foodstuffs of the lower valley had gone mostly down the Mississippi River to southeastern states and to foreign markets through New Orleans. After 1840, the flow of goods was increasingly to the east to feed the expanding population in the industrializing region from Pennsylvania northward. Initially, the main routes were through the Great Lakes. Rates were cheap, and via the Erie Canal and Hudson River to New York City. Eastward traffic over the Erie Canal grew fourfold between 1841 and 1851, then nearly doubled again by 1860. New canals from the lakes to the Ohio and Illinois rivers brought ever more of the hinterland into commercial reach. That tendency was confirmed and amplified by the explosive growth of railroads, starting in the early 1840s. Rail construction took place everywhere east of the Mississippi, including in the southeast. But if it is imagined as a race among regions, the old Northwest simply ran away from everybody else. Just under half of the new trackage was there, and when the Mid-Atlantic and New England states were added, the figure rose to nearly two-thirds. That, with the accelerating ship traffic through the Great Lakes, firmed up the consolidation of the Northeast-Old Northwest link. That link was further encouraged by the overland migration that began in the early 1840s. The new Midwestern rail and water connections were a natural conduit to the overlanders' embarkation points along the Missouri River, and Marshall's find gave the tendency a forceful shove. The superintendent of the 1860 census wrote, "The California gold had been a prime cause behind the nation's recent spurt of rail construction. The effects in the Ohio Valley and Great Lakes were especially electric. People there, already thoroughly aroused to the railroad's effect on dropping transportation costs and quickening trade with the East, now saw them also as the easiest and fastest ways to jumping off places from the Missouri Valley to the golden lands beyond." The census showed the effects. While a hefty portion of native-born immigrants to California in the first few years had come from the southeast, the numbers quickly shifted. By 1860, 42% had been born in five states bound by the new bonds of economy and movement: New York, Pennsylvania, Ohio, Illinois, and Indiana. Add in New England, and the portion rises to nearly 2 in 3. The respective numbers for all 13 slaveholding states were 28%, 9% from the deep southeast, and when Virginia is held out, barely 5%. Nearly twice as many in California had originated in New York alone than in all the deep southeast. These figures were a barometer of sectional power. As the populations of the Old Northwest and states to its east rose sharply, and as both areas pursued avidly the new systems of movement, their interests increasingly fused. The very notion of sections was evolving. Picture the new networks of commerce and movement as systems of chains binding New England and the Mid-Atlantic states ever more tightly to the Ohio Valley and Great Lakes. By the latter 1850s, they had fostered such a close economic and political kinship that it was sensible to speak of them together as a single region, the Northeast. Meanwhile, railroads to the south, almost without exception, were connecting the ports of the slave states to one another, rather than running northward. Northeast and southeast even used different gauges for their tracks. The new sectional alignment was firming up just as the nation acquired the West and as Marshall made his discovery. And within a few years, a growing majority of those heading into the new country came out of the Northeast, moving along the new routes to the Missouri Valley and beyond, in particular to the gold fields in San Francisco. After dominating the westward push for nearly half a century, the Southeast found itself outflanked and, as its share of the nation's population shrank, increasingly isolated. Southern expansionism, however, was anything but dead, and in fact the shifts of regional power gave it a kind of desperate energy, especially after news of gold arrived. Southeasterners had their own railroad dreams that would be central to their hopes to parlay political power into a clearer path to the Pacific for themselves and their institutions, in particular, African slavery. As some developments were straining relations between Northeast and Southeast, others were building the first links from the East to the Pacific. The two most consequential involved the federal government and business enterprises. They worked sometimes independently, often in partnership, and occasionally in opposition. Partnerships were most obvious at military posts on the overland trails, in particular Forts Kearney and Laramie along the Platte River and in eastern Wyoming. Up to 400 travelers a day mobbed Fort Laramie, peppering soldiers with questions on the simplest and best-known points, an officer wrote. They scarcely know where they are going. Commanders at both posts handed out food gratis to the most desperate cases. Blacksmiths repaired wagons. Post doctors cared for injuries and more dire cases of illness. Businesses from woodcutters to brothels sprang up around the forts, and many more sprouted along the trails. Ferries as a reprieve from treacherous crossings, and slapped together smithies for busted wheels and shoeless oxen. The first whiskey holes and crude road ranches gave way to well-stocked outfitters. Freighters to Salt Lake City, and after 1859, to Denver, dropped off goods to stock the shelves, flour, smoked meat, coffee, sugar, clothes, wine and brandy, books, hardware, barrels, blankets, cutlery, window glass, and more. One account book entry read, cocaine 1.00. Itinerant merchants stuffed wagons with goods and marketed their way westward. Counting on the distant call of nicotine, a Missourian in 1850 brought a great supply of chewing tobacco at 20 cents a pound, sold it along the trail at five times as much, and unloaded what remained in Salt Lake City at five times that, a 2,500% markup. Another traveler arrived in California, sold everything he had, bought a load of essentials, then doubled back and set up shop on the trail at bloated prices. "All those traders we met out there skinned us immigrants for all we were worth," he explained, "and now I have come back here to skin all the balance." By 1860, long stretches of the overland road had stores and other businesses every 10 miles or less, a sturdy thread of enterprise that, after the war, would feed other development all along its way. Culturally, it carried across the new country the entrepreneurial impulse that was so much a part of national life. One federal function, the mail, played an especially vital role in binding East and West. From the Republic's birth, the Postal Service had been one of the federal government's few unquestioned responsibilities, one that settlement on the Pacific strained as never before. Besides the needs of government and the most basic business coordination across the continent, the mail nurtured the intimate bonds to a national diaspora. It is hard to exaggerate the gnaw of separation felt by many on the far coast, and hard as well to overstress the value of the post. Some men wrote letters home almost daily. There was something about writing on and touching paper that would be touched by distant loved ones that bridged the separation. One man went farther, leaving drops from a nosebleed. "I leave my mark here with a little sprinkling." Often men waited despairingly for weeks without an answer. Then, with luck, elation. "There is a charm, a witchcraft in a letter from home," William Perkins wrote. "A man is transported at once in spirit to the scenes he has left behind." "Henry Page was almost crazy for news from you," he wrote his wife, "and so, let your motto be like mine. Write, write, write." Even before California was acquired, Congress contracted with two firms to meet the need: the United States Mail Steamship Company from New York to Chagres on Panama's east coast, and the Pacific Mail Steamship Company from the other side to California and Oregon. In yet another of expansion's helpful coincidences, their first runs, in late 1848 and early 1849 by the steamships Falcon and California, provided the first maritime passage to the diggings, and in the years ahead, gold seekers crowded the decks and berths of every postal ship. The maritime postal contracts were, in effect, a federal immigration subsidy. Contracted companies milked it to the maximum. The first mail moving overland, government dispatches carried by Christopher Kit Carson, took 3 months to go from Monterey to St. Louis. By 1851, there was monthly service from Independence, Missouri to Sacramento. But the huge demand and spotty service eventually demanded more. By then, this fundamental service was caught up in rivalries between Southeast and Northeast. In 1857, Postmaster General Aaron V. Brown, formerly governor of Tennessee, contracted with John Butterfield's Overland Mail Company to carry the post by a long, looping route called the Oxbow, from St. Louis on the Gulf Coast across southwestern deserts, and then up California to San Francisco. The huge operation, more than 800 persons, 1,500 horses and mules, and 250 coaches, and 141 stations, crossed the 2,800 miles in the required time of 25 days or less in each direction. Critics of the Oxbow route called for a far shorter connection, roughly along the Overland Road, and favoring states to the north. They won a modest contract, but when its subsidy was slashed in 1859, it appeared doomed. The famed Pony Express was a last-ditch effort to save the Northeast's mail link to California, and with it, one of the West's most prominent businesses. The freighting firm of Russell, Majors, and Waddell serviced army posts with thousands of tons of goods annually, but in 1860, the grand schemes of William Russell had left it teetering on collapse. Their only chance, the owners decided, was to grab the plush government subsidy from Butterfield, and to make the case for the central route, they promised to deliver the mail in well less than half the time of the overland mail. On April 3, 1860, two riders set off from St. Louis and Sacramento to begin relays between 100 stations across the Plains, Rockies, and Sierra Nevada. At 5 days, riders exchanged bags, and in five more they galloped into their respective destinations. The image of young men racing cross-country, the company called for young, skinny, wiry fellows, enthralled the public, as it has ever since. But behind the show were larger lessons, with business powerhouses wrestling for millions in government funds, and behind them sectional politicians squaring off over control of the new country and the fate of the old. The gamble failed. Even charging $5 per every half-ounce carried, Russell, Majors, and Waddell lost money, and in October 1861, a transcontinental telegraphic connection made the pony irrelevant. The whole point of the effort, a government contract, did not materialize. The firm's debts spiraled up and its credit down, until it went under in 1862. William Russell, the quixotic champion of a central route and of his own baronial ambitions, rode ever stranger schemes into scandal and disgrace. At his death in 1872, he was selling patent medicines. Even as events in the East slid toward disaster, however, the mail carried on. In 1859, the Overland Postal Service bore 20 tons a month, and steamers delivered more than 2 million letters and nearly twice as many newspapers. The government eased the way. It charged a bulk rate for newspapers and dropped postage for letters from 40 cents to 6 cents in 1851, then raised it to 10 cents in 1855. Expenses were 8 times receipts. The Postmaster General figured his office was spending $4.14 per person west of the Rockies, compared to the national average of 41 cents. Service to the Pacific was wholly impractical, he concluded. But of course, it continued. Sustaining a federal presence on the Pacific was a matter of connections, with letters of credit and letters from home equally vital. And so the government went deep into the red, subsidizing the economic and emotional life in its new, far-flung outposts. The role of business was even more emphatic on the westward route by sea. Out of it came an early case how the gold rush could rebound eastward in making financial barons of the age. Cornelius Vanderbilt, already commander of a system of steam transport centered in New York, hoped to challenge the United States Mail Steamship Company and the Pacific Mail Steamship Company with a second Isthmian route, this one across Nicaragua. From Greytown on the Caribbean coast, steamboats chugged up the San Juan River and across Lake Nicaragua, before travelers finished with a short, steep descent to the Pacific by carriages, mules, and porters. As many as 13,000 persons chose the new route over the next 5 years. To carry gold seekers to Nicaragua, Vanderbilt built several ocean-going steamships that became the basis for transatlantic business. He turned profits from that toward the other realm of steam power, railroads. On his death in 1877, Vanderbilt's estimated wealth equaled a full percent of the nation's gross domestic product. Western gold, plus the technological revolution that was creating the West, propelled the career of one of the East's towering capitalists. There would be others. Meanwhile in Panama, an even more ambitious project was underway. The tortuous, fever-ridden trudge across the isthmus quickly brought calls for a railroad, and William Aspinwall, president of the Pacific Mail Steamship Company, took the lead, organizing the Panama Railroad Company and raising $1 million, a fifth of what was needed, as it turned out. The challenge was colossal. Tens of millions of cubic yards of gravel were poured into miles of swamp to build a roadbed. The rainy season of several months left workers slaving in water waist-deep. Yellow fever, malaria, and cholera forced the company constantly to shuttle out sickened workers and shuttle in new ones, sometimes fully flushing their workforce every 2 weeks. Still, the project crept ahead, financed by travelers using the completed stretches on either side as they pinched toward the middle. Finally finished in 1855, the Panama Railroad ran 47 miles, crossing 170 bridges and rising as much as 60 feet in a mile. This first transcontinental link reduced travel from ocean to ocean from days to 3 hours. It had cost about 6,000 lives. Both Isthmian options were pricey, about $1,000 for the full trip, but traffic increased as facilities improved. The 120,000 persons between 1855 and 1860 more than doubled the number of overlanders. For all the popular fascination with the trek by wagon across plains, deserts, and mountains, by 1860, the majority of Americans who had traveled to the Pacific coast had come by sea, born by a system made from a marriage of big business and government support. The partnered enterprises were a prelude to others in the West after the Civil War. By 1860, the distance from east to west, measured not in miles, but by the difficulty and time needed to cross it, had shrunk significantly. The making of those connections, from the repatterning of traffic in the east to the rivalries over mail routes in the west, initially fed the worsening sectional contest that nearly tore the nation apart, even as the connections themselves implanted unifying institutions into the new country. Families, common customs, and powerful economic interests and more, bonds that would build vigorously after the Civil War. In all this, there was a certain irony. The earliest arrivals from the East called out desperately for more efforts to bridge what they felt was the terrible isolation of the far West. Developments of the 1850s, the mail coaches and steamships, military posts, ferries, businesses, and the Isthmian Railroad answered the demand. And yet initially, and paradoxically, being so cut off from the world was a trigger of success. Separation, it turned out, could breed a dynamism that in turn would shape profoundly an emerging West. Multiplication. California's early development was unique among American frontiers. Three overlapping circumstances explain why. The goldfields quickly generated enormous amounts of raw wealth. As scores of thousands crowded into what was suddenly one of the most desirable destinations on earth, they created a voracious demand for a wide range of goods and services. Finally, there was California's isolation. It was thousands of miles, in many cases tens of thousands, from those who wanted to go there, and from the obvious sources of what it needed. In practical terms, California was what it appeared to be on the earliest maps, an island. Each of the three circumstances is obvious by itself. It is together that they shed their brightest light. The combination, prodigious wealth, hungry demand, and isolation, created a unique dynamic. Economists speak of the multiplier effect. When money is spent, it not only brings something to the spender, money also gives whoever gets it the chance to spend it again, and when they do, somebody else gets another chance. At each step, as money changes hands, it stimulates demand for whatever is bought, clothes or a meal or a spin of a roulette wheel, and that eventually has physical effects. New dry goods stores, restaurants, and gambling halls. Those businesses in turn take in money and hire workers, who spend their wages in other stores down the street. Thus $100, as long as whoever gets it turns around and spends it, pays for economic activity many times its face value. It affects multiply. That certainly happened in California. While much of its gold migrated elsewhere, much was spent where it was mined, and millions of dollars more poured in as investments. Strictly in economic terms, the rippling effects were impressive. The multiplier metaphor can be pushed further. With so much to be done, and done so far from sources of support, much of the new society had to be built essentially from scratch. Rather like money's multiplying consequences, with each dollar bouncing and prodding activities in the same vicinity, each new development both met some new need and stimulated a need for some other, a demand that often had to be satisfied locally. It was development in ricochet. Precisely because much of that development began from a dead stop, unimpeded by any previous arrangements, those in command, if they could find a way on this far rim of the nation, could begin with advanced technologies and forms of organization. A good part of California's frontier economy was born modern. Quickly, the effects accumulated. Inside of a decade, there was a collection of institutions and facilities far more elaborate and sophisticated than on earlier American frontiers. Those frontiers had been far closer to their motherlands and could rely on them more for their basic needs. California was both farther away and in far greater need. In effect, it had to become its own motherland, especially in the crucial early years before the Panama Railroad quickened the flow of goods from the East. It produced everything from glassware and milled flour to boilers and work pants. It developed as well its own infrastructure of roads, coaches, steamboats, and soon enough, rails to circulate within itself and to connect to the outside. Born from gold and the rush to get it, it was a historical multiplier that birthed a startlingly mature economy, poised to reach into the interior and play a role for much of the West that the distant East had not played for it. Agriculture was a good example. At the outset of the rush, California was a growling stomach. Hunters soon exhausted most accessible game, and most foodstuffs had to come from Oregon, Mexico, Chile, Hawaii, and Australia. The sea turtle populations on the Galapagos Islands crashed as hundreds were caught and shipped to California. Soon, however, local production boomed. The number of California farms grew from 872 to 18,716 between 1850 and 1860. Improved land from a bit more than 30,000 acres to nearly 2.5 million. The value of farms in 1860 was a dozen times that of a decade before. Garden produce that seemed to a local editor a spontaneous production of the soil brought stunning profits. $40,000 from 16 acres of potatoes near Sacramento. Especially impressive was the expansion in what Californians had grown for generations, starting with grapes for wine and brandy to slake the miners' prodigious thirst. The million-bearing vines recorded in 1855 grew to 8 million 5 years later, and 28 million in 1870. 40 counties reported orchards in 1860, the start of an industry that would boom spectacularly later. The boom in wheat was even more dramatic. The long, hot and dry summers in the San Joaquin and Sacramento River valleys could produce huge harvests of grain that held up well when transported long distances. Great tracts of land, effectively a land monopoly, were turned to farming on a grand scale, and production was soon mechanized with gang plows, headers, and other machinery imported or made in San Francisco. A deep labor pool of Indians, Mexicans, and disappointed miners was on hand for planting and harvesting. Wheat production, virtually nil in 1852, consequently exploded to nearly 6 million bushels in 1860. By the mid-1850s, markets in the mining camps in San Francisco were saturated. Producers looked abroad, not only around the Pacific to Australia, Chile, Peru, Hawaii, and China, but also, of all places, to England. Half of the state's wheat exports in 1860 went to Liverpool and London. So too with ranching. For decades, ranchos in Southern California had raised large herds to export their hides and the tallow from their hooves and horns. With gold, the price of meat spiked spectacularly. Tens of thousands of animals were driven north to be slaughtered at the diggings, and tens of thousands more were driven in from the Midwest and border southeast. Within a dozen years of the gold discovery, the already considerable cattle population had increased tenfold. The California ranches were supplying markets in Oregon and Nevada. Sheep increased during the same period from 17,000 to more than 1 million, and butter production from about 700 to more than 3 million pounds. As in wheat production, ranching as business rapidly matured. In the mid-1850s, two German immigrant butchers, Henry Miller and Charles Lux, began raising cattle close to San Francisco to supply their shops there. By the Civil War, they were well on their way to fashioning an enterprise strikingly modern in structure, legal strategies, and manipulation of resources. All these enterprises showed another of California's advantages. Its immigrant stewpot brought together traditions and innovations that made it an especially fertile ground for new enterprises. Agricultural developers came from careers in quarrying, meatpacking, milling, and the China trade. Former trapper William Wolfskill settled in Los Angeles in the 1840s and married into the influential Lugo family and began a winery that by 1859 produced 50,000 gallons, 15% of the state's total. Another key figure in the expanding wine industry, the Hungarian Augustin Haritzi, had founded a Wisconsin town, written a travel account of America, and operated a Mississippi steamboat. The pattern, over and over, was of varied backgrounds and fertile ideas set to work where there were great needs, but little precedent on how to meet them. By the 1860s, descriptions of agrarian California were as boosterish as those of the early mines. "Winter is not winter at all," wrote the Overland Monthly, "but one long, subdued spring before hot summers brought abundant yields." Claims grew ever more extravagant. During a brief enthusiasm for silk, a promoter estimated that its foreign sales could retire the entire national debt. sprawling compendia appeared. One claimed California fields had produced a 210-pound squash, a 10-pound carrot, a beet 5 feet long, and a tomato 2 feet around. The word was spreading. Haresti reported that Europeans were universally surprised that a state so young and so isolated had so quickly advanced in agricultural production and technique. In fact, it was exactly California's isolation and youth, plus lots of money in demand, and a flood of new ideas that brought about the impressive results. By the Civil War, California was not only mostly feeding itself, it was ready to send what it grew into a market with a radius worthy of the circumference of its tomatoes. Manufacturing showed the same pattern, with a wrinkle. Scarcity of coal and iron held back heavier production, while high wages and interest rates and tastier opportunities in mining and land diverted investment elsewhere. Still, the demand of immediate needs brought a remarkable industrial burst, especially when raw materials and markets were close together, as with lumber and flour. During the 1850s, lumber and flour mills increased respectively from 10 to 279 and from 2 to 91. There were other examples. California produced consumer goods ranging from beer, furniture, crackers, ground coffee and mustard, sugar, and coffins to woolens, sails, glassware, matches, boots and shoes, brooms, soap, pianos, and billiard tables. The need for machines to turn out such goods inspired the start of heavier production. By 1870, one out of eight California steam engines was in a flour mill, most of them made in-state. To provide for the diggings, factories south of San Francisco's Market Street produced hoses and nozzles for California hydraulic mining, and later pumps, stamps, amalgamating pans, and retorts for the silver boom across the Sierra Nevada. In manufacturing, San Francisco had a base it would build on after the war. In commerce, it was soon serving a market second in size only to Chicago's. In the 1850s, well before Levi Strauss began making what would become the most popular style of trousers in history, California birthed other international consumer dynasties. In 1850, William Bovee established the Pioneer Steam Coffee and Spice Mills to offer coffee ready to use instead of the green beans miners had to grind and roast. To help build the shop and market the coffee, he hired an ambitious New England teenager who saved his pay and bought into the business. At 35, he became a full partner in the firm, and 7 years later, James A. Folger bought out the others and gave his own name to what would become the leading coffee producer in the United States. John M. Studebaker took $8,000 he made building wheelbarrows in the market town of Placerville and invested it in his brother's Indiana business, making phaetons, sulkies, and other horse-drawn vehicles. Early in the next century, with wheelbarrow Johnny as president, the firm began its first production of automobiles. The rapid muscular development just as quickly began to offset one of the very conditions that had helped produce it, California's isolation. It had never been total, of course, and its sparse outside trade in 1848 spiked with the first word of gold. Almost all of it came by sea, and in fact it would for decades, even after completion of a rail connection to the east. San Francisco quickly became one of the busiest ports in the hemisphere. Nearly 600 million pounds of goods arrived during the 10 months after April 1849, and during the summer, as many as 500 ships stood at anchor. Those connections, in turn, fed what would be one of the gold rush's most consequential legacies. For more than half a century, Americans and Europeans had shown a growing interest in the vast Pacific Ocean. Several expeditions, culminating with the remarkable United States Exploring Expedition, 1838 to 1842, toured the Pacific with an eye not only to filling in the map, but also to feeling out commercial possibilities. Atlantic merchants sent hundreds of ships to traffic in the pelts of otters, sea and land, fur seals, and beavers, and later the hides of the California cattle that would provide the first beefsteaks in the diggings. As the fur trade declined, another was rising sharply. An enormous fleet of American whalers, 700 of them in 1850, harvested tens of thousands of gray, white, sperm, and bowhead whales to supply illuminating and lubricating oil. Honolulu was an ideal pivot point for the quickening traffic. Between 1824 and 1848, nearly 1,000 commercial ships docked there, with with cargoes ranging from cigars, bearskins, and German stuff for trousers, to Italian brandy, and, from one ship, 51 French accordions. As 1848 opened, hundreds of ships sailed with growing confidence and familiarity along the sea lanes connecting Canton, Melbourne, and Hong Kong with Callao, Monterey, and Lima. And then, California gold. Goods began to pour into San Francisco as farmers in Oregon, Chile, and Peru sent shiploads of wheat, fruit, and beef on the hoof. Australia sent dray horses, bricks, tents, potatoes, and blankets of kangaroo hide. Hawaiian merchants shipped the food they had supplied to whalers as well as sugar, coal wood, salt, whale oil, and coffee. Soon the flow reversed as the telescoped economic development produced a surplus of some goods. On his visit to Taiwan in 1854, the California timber entrepreneur Nathaniel Crosby opened the first foreign trade there in two centuries. Traffic surged around the Pacific system. Between 1848 and 1864, the tonnage of freight arriving in Hong Kong grew tenfold. In 1856, nearly one ship in six arriving in San Francisco, 42 of 246, was from China. As Eastern politicians crowed over the nation's blessed future in the goldfields, boosters along the coast had their own foretelling. "That we shall have the boundless Pacific for a market is manifest destiny," wrote an Oregon editor. "We are bound to command it." The trade, and the bloviation, would only grow in the years ahead. California's internal connections were developed as well. Goods landed at the Golden Gate were sent up the Sacramento River and its tributaries. In 1852, 165,000 tons of cargo arrived in the inland port of Sacramento, near the junction of its river namesake and the American River, and was carried from there to the mines. The earliest traffic in skiffs and whaleboats shifted to steamboats by the summer of 1849, with at least 50 chugging along the Sacramento the next year. After vicious competition sank a ticket price from $30 to $1, rivals united into the California Steam and Navigation Company and carried people at $10 a head and freight at $8 a ton. Traffic along the first crude roads was by mule trains. Along a single route out of Marysville, nearly 400 Mexican arrieros, muleteers, worked 2,500 animals carrying foodstuffs, furniture, lumber, millstones, and at least one iron safe of 352 pounds. The mule carrying the safe died on arrival. As roads were improved, wagons appeared, and in 1849, the first stagecoaches. Travel on them, at first, was what one woman called the most excruciating that it was ever my lot to be victimized in. But with few options, companies proliferated. By 1853, Sacramento alone hosted a dozen lines capitalized at a third of $1 million. As conditions gradually improved, dozens and eventually hundreds of Concord coaches came by ship. In 1853, several firms combined into the California Stage Company, which bought and bullied its way into near total control. Its routes ran nearly 2,000 miles inside the state by 1858, the year it opened a line to Oregon. The first means over the Sierra Nevada was a little track like a footpath, but by 1858, 64 toll roads were operating. The discovery of silver that year in what would be the Comstock lode upped the need for connection. 4 years later, a single toll road out of Placerville brought in $3 million a year by accommodating 50,000 persons and 30,000 tons of freight. By then, each California town of significant size was well bound to every other. That in turn birthed other fusions of private and state enterprise. A prime example was the mail. After going to huge expense and effort to get the post to California, Washington failed miserably in getting it to addresses. San Francisco's single facility became in effect a general delivery office for tens of thousands of persons scattered over tens of thousands of square miles. A single shipment in November 1849 held 45,000 letters that took 3 days to sort. Alerted to a mail ship's arrival by a large black ball hoisted atop Telegraph Hill, crowds waited in long queues worked by coffee and food vendors. In the end, many were turned away with a shake of the head. The result was a new business, the Express. The first expressmen were small-time entrepreneurs. William Ballou financed his business selling beans bought from a Chilean ship. who quickly became something like saviors with saddlebags. The founder of one express company thought that anyone back home might have laughed at men greeting the mail. Such hurrahing, jumping, yelling, and screaming. The demand soon drew Eastern firms, first Adams and Company, 1850, and then Wells Fargo and Company, 1852, that offered the most direct and by far the fastest connections from coast to coast, and then delivered to the camps. A parcel or letter sent between San Francisco and New York arrived in barely a month, well ahead of the government post. Driving it all was what drove everything else. Gold. Expressmen first carried it in oyster cans and butter kegs, later in well-guarded strongboxes. The delivery fee was sweetened by juggling how gold changed in value as it traveled. William Brown, who started an early express after deciding he might mine for years and not get my whack, carried coins with his letters, bought dust in the diggings for $16 an ounce, and sold it for $17 in San Francisco, a tidy 6.25% profit. Wells Fargo did the same, continentally, buying California gold for $16 to $17 an ounce and selling it to the Philadelphia Mint for $18. Much of the gold it sent was from customers needing to transfer its worth across the country. A miner sending money home, or a merchant ordering goods, would provide dust to an agent for a fee and receive a letter of credit, which he would post, probably via Wells Fargo, somewhere back east, where the recipient would redeem it at a Wells Fargo office, again for a fee. Wells Fargo would carry the dust itself and would profit still more as its value appreciated between San Francisco and Philadelphia. Every clerk was now a financial agent positioned to deal with both material things and with the movement of numbers. From there, it was a small, predictable step into basic forms of banking. Wells Fargo and Adams & Company soon offered loans based on the dust that sat in its safes, some of it waiting for redemption, some for safekeeping, and drawing interest lower than what was charged for loans. Banking quickly became central to their operations. Adams & Company dominated until early 1855, when a financial panic forced all California banks to close their doors. Only Wells Fargo had kept adequate assets on hand, and it soon reopened and eclipsed the competition.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.